Benny, hey man, thanks a lot for hosting us here today, me and Waterski Nation, to do the ultimate skier. And what a beautiful place that you call your home and your backyard, and we appreciate you having us here. So your segment of the ultimate skier is stacking and posture. And, you know, I've obviously watched you ski for a lot of years, not from the boat, but from shore and at pro tournaments. And I got to ride in the boat today when you skied, which is probably the first time I've, other than maybe if I judged at a tournament. And I'm like, dude, did I pick the right thing for this guy? Like, your back is perfectly straight. I mean, so tell us how, like, is that natural? Is that like something your dad yelled at you about when you were young? Or is that something that, you know, you've developed over the years, just figuring out that this is the best way to stand on your ski? How did you get to be so straight and so stacked?
Well, cool. Thanks. I like it. I think I'll take it as a compliment. It's definitely been an evolution. So when I was a kid, I was everything but stacked. I skied really low on my ski, really compressed, you would call it.
Yep.
Had a really big gap between my handle and my hips. Because if you're down on the ski, it's really hard to have the handle close to your hips.
Right.
And everybody was telling me, basically, I got to reduce the gap between my hips and my handle. And I was like, well, I can't because my handle's on my knees.
Yep.
Like, I'm close, but I'm far away from my hips.
Yep.
And I think it's just because I was small. I was going all out. I was riding big skis for my size just because I was little.
Yep.
And then I never really thought about it. But I think as I grew up and I got stronger and I started riding more appropriate size skis, my posture kind of started going up on the ski and I started using my legs better.
Right.
And I kind of also saw the need for it because I feel comfortable when my handle is close to my body, especially my hips.
Yep.
So I would say the bigger the stakes are, the more I even think about that. Yep. And I'm like, if I'm going to do one thing, I'm going to have my arms and my body all together. It's going to be one tight little box.
Yep.
Like, and I don't want to give an inch.
Yeah.
And usually it tends to happen that the higher the event is or the most stakes are, the more I try to just stay compact.
Stick to that. Yeah.
Yeah, because I've noticed that when I skied really compressed, it's kind of shooting like a cannon. You don't really know what's going to come out when you come off the second wake.
Right.
But if you're in a stacked position and you're all connected, I think as you move off the second wake, it's very easy to approach the turn.
Absolutely.
A lot of people see like the turn is like, if something's not working in the turn, it's not really what you're doing at the turn. It's more coming from the lean. And so if your lean can be clean and efficient, I think then your turn will be smoother.
Yeah.
Be easier.
And that's what I see. Like, you made a comment out there while you were skiing, oh, I like to have my ski between me and the boat at the finish of the turn. And that's really the deal. Like, when your posture's really straight, I notice that you have a lot of torsional freedom when you change your edge. In other words, the boat's not torquing you back in.
Yeah.
You're able to carry that direction, which is equaling line tension, maintaining speed, setting, you know, the turn up to turn the way you want to turn. And what you said is very true. A lot of people, the result of their mistake is a poor turn, you know, but I always tell my students is that it comes down to two things, you know, space and line tension and stacking, you know, because let's face it, if you're early and the rope's tight, tell me a pass, you're not going to run.
Yeah,
you're
going
to
run
it. Exactly. So, you know, it goes to what you're saying is your key when you're in a stress situation or a bigger tournament, you focus more on your posture.
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool. That's awesome. And so what do you feel that the posture, like if you're at a tournament, let's say where the conditions aren't perfect and you're skiing, what do you know if you say to yourself, okay, when I get that connection that you were talking about, what's the result that you know for sure is going to happen, regardless of, like, is it that you're going to have time, you're going to have space, you're not going to be pushed into the turn? What is the result that you get from keeping such a good posture?
So the way I see it is if I manage to stay tight, I just create more space. So kind of like you were talking about, instead of just digging, like I can go as hard as I want.
Yep.
But I'm going as a whole and I'm putting all the energy straight to my ski.
Yep.
If I start just digging and not thinking about my posture, then I start creating bigger gap in between me and my handle, and I'm loading the boat a lot and I'm already a heavier person, so I don't want to load the boat as much as I possibly can. Most of the time it's going to hurt me. But if I can load the boat as much as I can while all the energy is going straight into the ski, then I'm using it to my advantage.
Right, then you get a benefit from it.
Yeah, so really the way I see it is the more I keep my hips up and the closer my handle is from my hip, the more all the power I'm putting is going straight into the ski.
Yeah.
And I get to the next buoy wider and earlier. And so like you said, if you're wide and early, anything can happen and you'll be fine.
Right.
Things start falling apart when you're narrow or you're late.
Yep.
That's when 100%. You can't recover from mistakes.
Yep.
So it just allows you to make more mistakes. And when you're in a environment like the Worlds we had this year in Malaysia or Mumba, where it's rolly, you want to be early and you want to be wide, in my opinion, even more than on just standard Miami Lake.
Yeah, when it's glass calm, if you're late and narrow, you can smash a turn and just, you're done.
Yeah, just wait a little bit and it'll come around. Yep. But in those conditions, you can't do that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so one thing I notice about you as well is like the transition from the finish of the turn into your lean, I don't see a break in your posture. Like I saw a couple turns today where your whole weight rocks forward, but I don't see ever where I see a lot of guys are like kind of hunting with their chest at the finish of the turn, and then you see them straighten up, which transfers the weight to the back of the ski at the finish of the turn. Is there something you're doing with your ski setup that allows you to stay so straight into the turn without feeling the need to kind of hunch into the front of the ski? Or is that just, again, you just know I want to stay locked the whole time and then at the finish of the turn it's going to be all good?
So I think it's a combination of the ski and the skier. And I think for me, the Syndicate skis have allowed me to find stability through the finish of the turn, so I can really move my hip straight through the turn and not be afraid that the front's not gonna be there to support me.
Okay.
Sometimes I would have to, like years back when my ski wasn't set up so well for me, I'd have to drop my hips back because I didn't feel the stability come from the front.
Right.
Now I'm able to feel my ski all the way through the turn, and so I can just stay on it and pivot as one and then come out sooner in a better position rather than have my hips back through the turn and then bring him back up.
Yep.
So I think it was both. It was, I think, the switch for me to HO skis, but also myself understanding better how to set up my ski for my personal style.
What you want to do.
And what you want to do. And what I found is when I can get my ski, like I was telling you, when I can get my feet to move as fast as I can back underneath the line at the end of the turn, that's when I feel comfortable and I don't have to break position. I can just remain in what I believe is the right position to be in.
Yep.
And it just happens right away.
That's awesome. So give us your 2019 highlight. What was your crowning moment of 2019?
Since Fred's here, he's in the background. You guys can't see him, but I would say skiing against Fred at the San Gervasio tournament.
Yeah.
In the head-to-head, that was a lot of fun. I hadn't done the cut the last 2 years in San Gervasio because I think it's a really harsh cut, which is good. It's competitive. They take 4 and 4. So I just squeezed in. So I was against first, which was Fred. And he pushed me to ski really well. He ran out and ran 5 at 41, I believe. And I ran 3, pulled for 4, which is tied my PB for
me.
So that was definitely a highlight for me this year, I'd say.
Yeah. And, you know, this series we're doing is the ultimate skier, and we couldn't do it without talking about Andy Mapple. So I know you're like one of the young pups on the tour.
Yeah.
You maybe didn't ski against Andy.
Yeah.
But I don't think there's anybody who slalom skis that hasn't been influenced one way or another by Andy Mapple. Can you tell us sort of, you know, I know he's come out here and skied with you out here. Can you tell us sort of what he means to you and how he influenced your skiing?
Well, lucky me, I didn't have to ski against Andy. That's what I'll tell you. The ultimate skier, I would say, is Bob Lapointe. If you're just going to say skiing, I thought when you watch videos from the guy ski back in the days on wooden ski, I'm blown away. But I would agree with you that the ultimate competitor and water skier of all time is Andy. I'm not going to disagree with that. I'm obviously a huge fan of him personally. I never really got to spend much time with him or didn't know him on a personal level, but I think he's impacted the whole skiing community, and every single athlete today that is skiing has in some way, shape or form been, whether they like it or not, or know it or not, impacted by Andy.
Yeah.
Whether it's boat design, like you said, or ski design, or fin design, or anything really.
Yeah.
So on a personal level for me, I had little interaction with him, unfortunately, but everyone I had was really special and really great, and he was always really nice and really welcoming, and I think at a stage in his career where he was really willing to share a lot of the stuff he knew.
Yep.
So I feel I didn't get a lot of Andy, but the little I got was pretty genuine and quite a lot of it for me, at least.
Awesome.
So, yeah.
Well, thanks for being a part of this, Benny.
Yeah, thanks for coming out.
Yep. We'll be right back.